Buenos días, gracias por compartir conmigo este nuevo día. Que sea bendecido en las promesas de Dios. Mi nombre es Pastora Ramona Guadalupe. Este programa viene del Ministerio de la Casa de Oración para toda persona. Hoy vamos a estar mirando el libro de segundo de Pedro, capítulo 3, versículo. Vamos a estar mirando todo el versículo porque es un capítulo bien pequeñito. Y es cómo vivir los otros. Porque siempre las promesas son para ti. La semana pasada hablé del libro de Mateo, capítulo 25, cuando era de los días de las madres y también los estudiantes que se están graduando esta semana también, que sea bendecido, bienvenido para ustedes, estudiantes de la universidad también. Yo oro que el Señor te vaya bendiciendo con este tema, ¿cómo vivir? Vamos a cortar un momentito para llorar para ti, para que el Señor te vaya bendiciendo este día. Señor Jehová, en el nombre de Jesucristo, yo oro para tu pueblo. Dale sabiduría y entendimiento, Señor. Todo esto yo te lo pido en nombre del Padre y del Hijo del Espíritu Santo. Gracias, Señor Jehová. Amén. I want to welcome you today to the Promises of God. My name is Pastor Ramona Guadalupe. This program comes to you from the House of Prayer for All People. Today's theme topic is how to live. How to live, or how are you supposed to live? Many of the students at this moment are graduating, especially from our universities and colleges, are graduating for the next month, next 2 weeks, and then the high school students in junior high and elementary will be graduating. Depends upon the part where in the country are you. But I bring you the messages, especially those who are graduating and you're going into the world. How should you live? Let me take this moment and pray for you that God will bless you. Blessed Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I pray for your people. Father, I ask of you to give them the wisdom and knowledge and understanding of your decree, blessed Father, and how should we live? Thank you, blessed Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Today I'm going to start in English and then I'm going to go to Spanish. You know, sometimes I like to do that. How should we live? In the book of 2 Peter, Peter writes a letter to the church. This is the second letter. It's called the epistle letter, that the letter went throughout the church in the Providence. And he reminds the people. It's a reminder. It's just one of his final reminder. Just like Jesus remind his people last week in the book of Matthew chapter 25, how Jesus is going to separate the sheep from the goat. And you're going to see the difference, that he's going to call all the nations, and all the nations are going to be in the foot of Jesus Christ. And he's going to separate, he's going to divide people, beloved. But today here is another final warning, and it's a letter that it was passed on to the churches. And Peter gives his comrade, you know, the people that believe Jesus Christ, that are followers of Jesus, a reminder how things are going to be. He reminds them and he encouraged them to stay focused on Christ and all that they have learned to the prophets and to the word of God. You know, he even gives an example how it's going to be. Beloved, this is a warning letter, just like the book of Matthew chapter 25. It is a warning for all of us. Many of you are busy and people getting married. But Jesus warns us before the second coming of Christ. He warns us. He says it's going to be like the day of Noah. The day of Noah, when Noah was building the ark and people were merry and dancing and building houses and giving into marriage and celebrating, until Jehovah tells Noah to close the ark. Once he brought in all the animals, keep in mind, people were laughing at Noah. This ark, it took many years to build. But when Jehovah rose from his throne and he told Noah to close the ark, and nobody realized what was happening, what was going to happen until the flood came. So Jesus used that as a metaphor. And he talks about, here Peter talks about that the second coming of Christ is going to be like the thief of the night. You may say, oh my goodness, this Pastor Guadalupe, she's always telling us things that are doom and gloom. But beloved, I do not want the rocks to cry out for me, beloved. Especially those who watch this program from around the world, I do not want the rocks to cry out for me. The reason why some people say, people been saying that and all that, and Jesus Christ, Jesus this, that he's going to be coming, but everything continues the same. But here in the epistle letter, Peter talks about 2 Peter verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come like the thief in the night. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. The earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of person ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly life as you look forward for the day of God and the speedy coming of This will bring you, beloved, this is the promise that Jesus gave us. This is the promise that has been given to us. It's going to be a new heaven. It's going to be a new earth. And the righteous will dwell. You know, the other day, beloved, this was Sunday. I'm in New York City. There was this church, 160-year-old church. In those days, they used to build the churches very well. Not now these days, a wind comes and blows them away. But I saw the pictures. I was on the internet and I checked the news on the internet. And I saw something that really, my hairs and my back and my neck stood up. I mean, it was a 4 to 5 alarm call for the fire, for the firefighters from all over came. And the pictures was unbelievable. Whoever took the pictures, the whole church was engulfed in flame. Mind you that they just finished celebrating. This was an Orthodox church in New York City. They were celebrating Easter this past Sunday. The Orthodox church has a different calendar. They were celebrating Easter. And on that evening, it was around 6 o'clock in the evening when the church were ablaze. But what really was profound to me, there was a specific photograph that the church had a circle, what is called the Rosetta. It's a big round circle right in, on top of the church building. And out of there was a gulf of flame that came out like a dragon. I mean, the flame just gushed right out of that hole itself. It was unbelievable. The reason why I share this with you, beloved, you might say, oh my goodness, that's a bad ointment, or somebody burned the church down. I don't know. But the whole idea is, this was a place of worship. We must ask ourselves, are we doing God's will? Not only going to a church and congregating, but are we doing God's will when we come out of the church? Beloved, over here it talks about, in verse 11 it says, that every element will be destroyed by fire. What kind of life should we live? On verse 10 it says, the day of the Lord will come like the thief, and the heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid waste. Beloved, our neighboring country, Canada right now, that there's a lot of parts in Canada that is, I mean, this fire going on and it's being set. Some of the scientists say that it's being set because of global warming. The earth is pretty dry, and out west and all the flood in Texas, you might say, oh, there she goes, apocalypse. You know, beloved, even scientists are saying that everything is happening in a fast, accelerated pace. Jesus makes it perfectly clear in the gospel. Before he comes, everything is going to be like the birth pain of a woman. And if you have never been around a woman that she's about to give birth in those last 2 weeks, it's not a happy thing. until the child is born. Jesus even used that metaphor. You know, she goes to the 9 months, and you know, when that time is closed for her to deliver, and that child comes into the world, Jesus makes it perfectly clear, beloved, let's prepare ourselves, our hearts, and live a life of godliness. This is the final letter, that one of the final letters that Peter writes to the church. He writes to the church and he warns the church. This is one of his final letters, and then then John writes a letter too to the church. It is to warn us. You know, the way that we have in the United States these new running mate for the president candidates, you could always tell where the pendulum is heading on this society, and it's not good. You have leaders that entice strife and cause riots, and they speak with each other. I mean, terrible. Their mouth is like frogs comes out of their mouth. They accuse each other. They blame each other. They bring things from the past into the forefront. They throw each other under the bus. Each candidate that is running for president, this is what they're doing. And if you look at what is happening around us, do you not know that our behavior affects the climate? Do you not know that whenever you spill blood, it causes chaos? Do you not know that our children are dying of drugs? What is happening? Oh, you could have all the money and all the program, but what is missing here? What is missing? The core of all things. They're trying to escape from what? Look at our leaders who are running for to be one of the greatest positions in this country. I don't care whether you are Vermonter or you are New Yorker or you are Texas. It doesn't matter. Your behavior is affecting everything. You're accusing each other. They accuse each other of things, and they throw each other in the bus. And then you have those that cause riot because these leaders are enticing strife. The pendulum is going in the wrong direction. Our youth are dying, committing suicide. Teachers are raping and having sex with our students. Leaders, embezzlement, our local town leaders, the ones in our town clerk, robbing from the citizen in the community. Beloved, the pendulum is heading in the way of disaster. So what do we do? What kind of life should we live? Here Peter writes and he warns us, what kind of life, when you start seeing all these things, because it's a promise, all the elements of this world will be destroyed by fire. And everything will be laid waste, beloved. You know, when I saw the article of these houses being burned, what is happening? This drought. Jesus made it perfectly clear. When they accused Jesus Christ and he went to the court of the leaders, he tells the people, the women that were crying, he says, don't cry for me. Cry for yourself and your children. Because Jesus came for a purpose, to pay the price for our sins, beloved. Cry for our children. They are dying. They're committing suicide. Teachers no longer respect the sanctity of a child. You have candidates that they throw each other in the bus, under the bus, and they point and accuse each other. Do you not know accuser? Who's the accuser? The word accuser, according to the biblical term, is Satan himself. All this riot that is happening, racism, discrimination, people doing things, and approving things that are forbidden for our youth. Beloved, what do we do? Those God wants you to stay focused. This is a warning. Last week in Matthew 25, it was another warning. Peter, which was a servant of Christ, here he writes a letter to the church. This is the second letter. It is a warning again, beloved. So how should we live when we start seeing all these things and knowing how the end is going to be? Since everything will be destroyed, everything's going to be destroyed. How should we live? How should we live, beloved? The question, I leave that to you for you to answer that, for you to get right with God, because the way we are going way off. We already crossed the line. Do you know, do they have statistics, people who study the moral value of a society? We have crossed that line, whether it's in the Middle East or United States or Canada, it doesn't matter. We have crossed those boundaries. Just like God put the boundaries for the moons and the sun, everything has a season. Can you imagine if the sun would do whatever it feels like it, and the moon would do whatever it feels like it, and the stars would do whatever it feels like it, and all the trees and all the fruits and all would do? Can you imagine that? There is a particular order in life to live. But we human beings, when I say human being, us, that we are made in the image of the Most High God, we have crossed those boundaries. So, beloved, this letter of warning, you might say, oh, there she goes again. She's always talking about Armageddon. But you know, beloved, I don't want the rocks to cry out for me. So I give you this. What kind of life should we live, especially for our young people that are graduating this year? I pray that you hold on to Christ. And if you don't know Christ, I pray that you cry out to him and you ask Christ for him to be your Lord in your life and to forgive you for all your sins. Because, beloved, it's really scary. And Jesus makes it perfectly clear on that day that he was carrying that cross. He says it. If they do this to me while the trees are still green, what would happen when the trees are dry? Can you imagine? If the trees are green right now, how are our people going to behave when things are scared and things are dry, beloved? So this is why we have to get closer to Christ, live a godly life, and keep away from all this stuff that is happening that are negative, that is going to kill you. Because Jesus says, the enemy comes to kill, to steal, and destroy. So all this drug epidemic that is happening to our youth, and this disgusting behavior of our teachers having sex with our students, these are things that we have to continue being in the forefront and praying to eliminate all the demonic spirits that are in this world. Because, beloved, no longer the schools pray. And then when a disaster happens, what does the school do? They pray. But what happened throughout every day? How come prayers are not there to protect our children, to protect our environment? We have become our worst enemy, beloved. So when a disaster happens, what people do? Light up candles, starts praying. How hypocrite are we, beloved? So this is a warning that Peter writes to the church. So I pray that you will be blessed. And let's go back into the precept of God. Beloved, things are not getting any better. Look around you. We have become a lost sheep in God's kingdom. So I pray that God will give you the wisdom and knowledge and understanding, beloved. Because Jesus says here, Peter reminds the church, that it's going to be the day of the Lord will come like the thief in the night. And Jesus makes that perfectly clear. It's going to be like the day of Noah. So I leave you with that. What kind of life should we live knowing that all the elements and will be destroyed by fire? May the peace of God be with you and the love of God continue surrounding you. Because keep in mind, the new heaven and new earth, that is your promise. Because the promises are for you in Jesus' name. Gracias por compartir conmigo este día. Yo empecé con inglés, pero aquí en el libro de Segundo de Pedro que habla, es un aviso que le da a toda la iglesia. Esta fue una carta que escribió. Y este aviso es, ¿cómo va a ser la segunda venida de Jesucristo? Jesucristo va a venir como un pillo de noche. En el libro de Segundo de Pedro, capítulo 3, versículo 10, que habla, dice, ¿cómo nosotros tenemos que vivir? ¿Cómo nosotros vivimos? Porque Jesucristo viene como un pillo de la noche. Y el cielo se va a desaparecer con un sueño. Y todas las cosas se van a destruir con fuego. Y también la tierra y todo se va a baratar. El versículo 11 habla, ¿cómo es si todo se va a baratar? ¿Cómo tenemos que nosotros vivir en la madera? Vivir en la madera que es santo para el Señor. Querido y querida de Dios, la juventud se están matando con drogas. Los maestros teniendo sexual con los estudiantes. Ya no hay respeto. Los líderes que quieren ser presidentes se hablan bien mal de cada uno. La pregunta es, te pregunto a ti, tú me puedes decir, ay, mira, pero pastora, tú estás hablando lo mismo. Pues tenemos que preparar los corazones porque ya vemos que todo está pasando como Jesucristo dijo. Él dice, la segunda venida de él va a ser como los partos de una mujer. Cuando una mujer tiene los partos, que no, cuando el niño va a salir, no sale ese momentito, sale poquito a poquito los dolores. Y eso mismo lo estamos viendo. Los líderes que quieren hacer presidente de Estados Unidos, la conducta, miren las conductas, cómo se hablan ellos. ¿Qué clase de ejemplo los líderes están dando para la juventud? Se están los líderes, como yo hablan, y la gente peleando, cayéndose encima, y el racismo que hay. La pregunta es, tenemos que preguntar, la juventud se está matando por la droga. Todo es porque abandonamos la madera de Dios. Porque la juventud no tiene nada que hacer. Cogen la droga, están con sus amistades. Pero la pregunta es, ¿se va a poner mal o se va a poner bien? Tenemos que compartir, venir para atrás al Señor. Porque ningún gobierno ni ningún programa te va a arreglar tu vida. Solamente Jesucristo te da el poder y entendimiento, querida. Porque estamos viviendo un tiempo que las cosas están yendo una manera que está cayendo todo. Cuando Jehová se levante de su trono, él se levantó y le dijo a Noé, porque Jesucristo dice, el día va a ser como los días de Noé. Todo el mundo estaba casándose, lavándose, haciendo casa y todo, fiesta. Y cuando Jehová se levantó de su trono y le dijo a Noé, cierra esa puerta. Y ahí cuando vino la agua y la gente se murieron. Aquí Jesucristo y Pedro avisa su gente que estamos viviendo en este tiempo. Tenemos que preparar los corazones los otros para caminar con Jesucristo otra vez. Porque el enemigo viene para matar, robar y quitar. Porque el enemigo quiere destruirte tu familia, tu comunidad, tu país. No solamente en Estados Unidos, pero también las otras partes del mundo. Porque los cristianos también están sufriendo, lo están matando. Todo esto, Jesucristo dijo que iba a suceder. Pero tenemos esperanza porque Dios dice, el libro de segundo, que va a ser una nueva cielo y también la tierra para lo que hacen bien para el Señor. Yo deseo que porque las promesas son para los otros. Tenemos que caminar, venir, vivir una vida diferente del mundo. Diferente, bien diferente. Porque el mundo quiere hacer lo que le dé la gana. Pero el Señor recuerda, tenemos que caminar como la madera de Dios. Que sea bendecido porque las promesas son para ti. Que sea bendecido. Yo no sé cuántos minutos yo tengo, pero tengo un poquito de minutos. Vamos a orar. Señor Jehová, en el nombre de Jesucristo, yo oro para tu pueblo. Ya estamos caminando una madera que es para destruir la vida de los otros, Señor. Yo oro para la juventud, por esta droga que está pasando, Señor. lloro para los matrimonios, que tú vayas bendiciendo los matrimonios. Señor, estamos perdiendo la juventud por esta droga. Y la familia, porque ya la juventud no conoce tu nombre, no conoce tu madera, Señor. Yo oro, Señor, que tú vayas bendiciéndole y ayudando a la juventud. En nombre de Jesús, amén. I want to take this moment and pray, especially for our youth that are dying and committing suicide in our community and every household. Let me just take this moment and pray. I'm not too sure how many minutes I have left, but I think I have a minute that I could pray briefly. Blessed Father, I pray for your people, especially for our youth that are dying, Father, for this overdose of different kinds of drugs. And Father, I ask of you to that your words and your ways will be in every household. I pray for mothers and fathers to give them the strength to help their children. And I pray for their children too, Father, that their friends, blessed Father, they get to know your ways so they influence each other. Blessed Father, protect our youth. All this I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. So, beloved, remember, the new heaven and new earth is promises for you because our adversary comes to kill and destroy you and your family. So we have to stand firm in the words of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you, because remember, the promises are always for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Recuerda, las promesas son para ti. Amen.
Yo le